foolish, disobedient, deceived, and serving diverse different lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. He said, that's what we were. We were sinners. We were candidates for hell. We were firewood to burn in hell forever. Before the love of God thought about us and reached us and came to us, but after that the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared. The love of Christ appeared. The love of God appeared. It's so broad that wherever, however far you have been, it reaches you and comes to you, not by the works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which is shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Lord, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. That's what he has done, and we give him the glory for that, and we're telling everybody else. We announce it to everybody else, no matter where they have gone, no matter what they have done, this love reaches them. It is so broad because God is not willing that any should perish, but that all shall come to repentance. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, reading from verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but his long-suffering towards what? Not willing that any should perish. Think about that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, and whosoever means you, whosoever means everybody else, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Because he is not willing that anyone should perish, in that verse 9, but that all, how many people? I said how many people? That all should come to repentance. The people that do not know how broad the love of God is. And they say God has chosen some few people to get to heaven. The blood of Jesus could not cleanse the rest of the people. They say God has chosen some people, the little sinners, and the people that have not gone too far, but some people have gone too far. They think the love of God is not broad enough to cover them. He wants all to come to repentance. And as you come, he will save you in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. In this was manifested the love of God toward us. It's the love of God towards us. And it's coming to you today in Jesus' name. Because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him, hearing his love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. He's done that in love, and his love reaches you, reaches everyone. Revelation chapter 1, reading from verse 5. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that, what did he do? Loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. He washed us. He cleansed us. We are converted. Our lives were transformed because of his love. The breath of Christ's saving love. Number two now is the length of Christ's sustaining love. We're coming to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 17. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. What's the secret of the Christian life? How is it we're able to live the Christian life without being moved? And without falling, and without rising and falling every day. Because we have Christ not in our head, but in our heart. He is the mighty conqueror. He is the mighty sustainer. He is the mighty supporter. He is the upholder of the whole universe. And he's our upholder. He's the one that upholds us, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, and that she be rooted and grounded in love. You know, you find some people, they depend on how they feel. If they feel good, they smile. They seem to love you when they feel good. If they feel sometimes unhappy, or sometimes there's too much heat, sometimes the breeze is not blowing on them, their attitude, their character depends on their feeling. But here it says that when you become a Christian, you're rooted and grounded in love. And then it says that you may comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and then the length of Christ's surpassing, sustaining love. You see, the love of Christ, it doesn't just come to the sinner and then gets him saved and said, now you are saved. Go ahead on your own and make sure you live the Christian life. Make sure you don't fall. Make sure that you do everything right. He doesn't leave us. He sustains us. He supports us. He succors us. He holds us up. He helps us to be who we ought to be. Look at the length of this love. We're looking at John chapter 13. John chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 1. It tells us, John chapter 13, verse 1. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come and that he should depart out of the world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. Having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. Think about that. For those apostles and disciples, he loved them unto the end of his own earthly life. He loved them unto the end of their own lives here on earth, so that whatever temptations they will face, whatever trial they will face, whatever conflict or whatever situation, circumstance they will face, he loved them unto the end. And then from generation to generation, all the believers in every generation, for everyone, he loves them to the end of their lives, until they lay their crosses down eventually and then go home to glory. He loves them to the end. And for you right there, you have been born again. You have the beginning of the Christian life, and then you are going to get to the end. I said you are going to get to the end. Because his love will not fail you. It will sustain you. It will support you until the day of the rapture. You know, sometimes as a Christian, when you see some challenges that you face, you're wondering, can I endure to the end? You will. I said you will. Because the love that saved you is the same love that sustains you. Look at chapter 17. John chapter 17. I'm reading from verse 11. You will see that it is the love that sustains. He wants to support you, sustain you. He wants to hold you up. That temptation will not destroy you. That trial will not destroy you. Look at this in verse 11. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. Keep them, support them, sustain them. Don't allow them to fall. I pray you will not fall. Amen. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost. None of them is lost. Thank God I will not be lost. I said, I will not be lost. You give your life to Christ, and you make that life to remain with Christ. Whatever may be happening, understand. You didn't come to Christ because of this, because of this, because of that. You came to Christ because you want to get to heaven eventually. Keep your eyes on the goal. Keep your eyes on the destination. Don't be distracted by this one did this to me, that one said that to me, that one did not give me this or did not give me that. That's not why you came. You came so that you will get to heaven. And heaven is your goal. You'll be there in Jesus' name. None of them is lost. Look at this. But the son of perdition. That's Judas Iscariot. I will not be Judas Iscariot. He stopped looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. All he wanted now was money, because he was keeping the bag. He was a treasurer among the disciples. And the money came close to his heart, closer than Jesus Christ. How could he get more money? How could he get more money? That was now his concentration. And he became a son of perdition. The love of money is the root of all evil. But if you keep your eyes on Christ, you might be weak, it will strengthen you. You might be tempted, it will sustain you. Because only the sons or the daughters of perdition will be lost. And I am not a son of perdition. I will not be a daughter of perdition. Say it for yourself. And now in verse 13, I come to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world. Even as I am not of the world, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world. What he means is, you see, go back to your office and work. You see, go back to your market and sell. You see, go back to your community and live there. Challenges are there, no doubt. Temptations are there, no doubt. And all these things that will distract your attention, they are there, no doubt. But the Lord is going back home with you. He goes to the market with you. He goes to society with you. He sustains you. That's why he says in verse 15, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. He will keep you from the evil. It says, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Chapter 14 of John. John chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 21. It tells us, he sustains us. He holds us up. In a time of temptation, we look up to the Lord. And the Lord keeps us away from falling. Chapter 14, verse 21. He that has my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, I will manifest myself to him. There will be manifestations every time in your life. That as you love the Lord and you sense the love of God, it shows up. It says, this is the way, that is the way. And the things you need to do, the things you need to have to strengthen your backbone and to make you stand all the days of your life, he manifests himself and he does that to you. And Judas says unto him, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the world? And Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me and keep my words. If you love the Lord, you'll keep the words of the Lord. Loving the Lord is not feeling. Loving the Lord is not, you know, moving when you are singing. Loving the Lord is not dancing. Loving the Lord is not something sentimental. Loving the Lord means that all your will, all your heart, your mind is to obey the words of the Lord. That is love. And my Father will love him, and we, Father and Son, will come unto him and make our abode with him. That's what sustains us. That's what keeps us victorious in the time of temptation. The length of the love of God is infinite. It is endless. It is eternal. It is everlasting. It's so long you cannot see the end of it. None is so far away as to be unreachable. The prodigal backslider, the Lord reaches him in the far country. The persecuted believer in a lonely place, the Lord reaches him and is not forgotten. The weak, the tried, the tested, the tempted, and everyone, those who are tired, the Lord reaches out to them. It is sustaining love. The oppressed and the discouraged disciples, the persecuted converts, the young, inexperienced children of God, and the old, feeble saints of God. all can have the support and the sustaining power of his love. In fact, he tells us in Romans chapter 8, how the love of God reaches out to us in any condition in which we are. Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 35, it says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Can anything separate you from the love of Christ? Let's reach out to you every time, because they are not so powerful as to restrict him, as to restrain him, as to stop him from loving you. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, tell me, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? There are some people that are they're short-sighted about the love of God. Once they don't have a little breakfast to eat, they say, where is God? God is still there. In the same place he was when the Son of God died for you on the cross of Calvary. He's still there. And once maybe there is a little noise, a little accident somewhere or something like that, they say, where is God? He's still there. And his love is still there. And you'll find that that love will sustain you in that challenge and difficulty in Jesus' name. He goes on to say, as it is written, for thy sake we're killed all the day long. That just means we're persecuted. They oppose us. They fight against us. But we have won already. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, tell me, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. He sustains us. That's why those difficulties and challenges never will destroy the faith of the believer. He now goes on to say in verse 38, for I am persuaded. If you are as persuaded as Paul the apostle of the love of God, you will not fall. I said you will not fall. It's because you are not persuaded that God is love. You are not persuaded that through all these things, it will still sustain you and support you. That's why you are shaking. But if you become persuaded of this love of God, the breadth and the length of the love of God, the love of Christ, which passes understanding. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depths, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This love will keep you to the very end. Jude, reading from verse 21. Jude, reading from verse 21. Stay in that love. Remain in that love. And that love will sustain you. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Keep yourselves in the love of God. When the world shows hatred, come back to the love of God. When the world is trying to harass your life, come back to the love of God. Understand, he loves me. God loves me. Christ loves me. And the Bible tells me so. And whatever I see around me, I can always look up to the love of God. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. In verse 20, for now, unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Read that personally. Now unto him that's able to keep me from falling, he will keep you from falling. To present you and to present you faultless before the presence.